Hi everyone, I'm Michael Short. This is Let's Go Outdoors.
Let's go outdoors where the waters run clear and cold. Mother Nature's world is better than gold. So much to see, so much to do. Let's go outdoors, me and you. Let's go outdoors.
Let's Go Outdoors with Michael Short. Supported by the Alberta Conservation Association. Conserving Alberta's wild side.
Hi everyone, welcome to Let's Go Outdoors. I'm Michael Short. Coming up, we go on a pheasant hunt with a number of first-time youth and women hunters. We attend an Arctic grayling conference in Grand Prairie to better understand why these fish are disappearing from our rivers and streams. Brad Fenson will be along with a few tips on spotting scopes and binoculars. And we take a closer look at a joint project between two conservation groups that benefits antelope.
It's not every day that you get an opportunity to crawl around in the dirt looking for fossilized dinosaur bones. Yet that's exactly what we're doing here at the Dinosaur Provincial Park just outside of Brooks.
Today we're heading down to Tabor, Alberta. Yes, the corn capital of Canada. But this town of almost 9,000 has a significant sugar beet operation as well. And now, Tabor can add the title of hosting the first Pheasant Festival. For the past week, hunters from across Alberta, and in fact from out of province, have been participating in this event. The festival is a joint effort between a number of conservation organizations as well as many local businesses and individuals, and is supported by the Tabor Chamber of Commerce. Now, one of the objectives of the Pheasant Festival is to introduce first-time hunters to this activity. Earlier in the week, a number of women and youth hunters were given an opportunity to hunt pheasants with the help of some volunteer mentors. To generate more interest in pheasant hunting, the Alberta Hunter Education Instructors Association and other conservation groups organized a first-time hunting day just outside Tabor. Hot chocolate and coffee was in high demand as the morning brief got underway, outlining safety procedures for the day.
The two key parts of today is, number one, that you have a lot of fun, that you really enjoy what you're doing, and number two is that we do it with safety.
It's going to be single shot only today. Mentors are going to handle all ammo. Even on the range here, we're going to just have a controlled environment for everybody.
Whoa!
Good. How did that feel? Did it kick you hard?
Not really, no.
Not too bad, hey?
Most of the morning was spent on the practice range, as many of these first-time hunters have never fired a shotgun, let alone tried to hit a moving target. This is where experienced hunters proved invaluable in offering some advice.
Pull.
There it is. That was confident.
Cool.
That was your best. Best hit so far.
I was a little nerve-wracking with everybody watching, but once I hit it, it felt pretty good and it was fun. I'd like to do it again.
After a quick lunch break, it was time to head out. To provide these novice hunters with realistic conditions, the pheasants are released in a field with birds that were purchased through a local hatchery.
One. That's called 99.
That's called a volunteer.
Now it's time for the mentors and dogs to go to work.
Basically, kind of a general rule of thumb is you want your gun to either be horizontal or up in the air. Anything that's pointing down at the gun or down at the ground, it's generally a no shot because you might hit the dog.
While the dogs do their part by flushing the birds, the rest is up to the hunter.
Oh, you were so close.
These birds move fast. Eventually, the effort put in at the practice range earlier in the day pays off.
Hey, Josh! All right, Josh!
What did you do?
I got him.
What'd you get?
I got a pheasant.
Right on. Is that your first pheasant?
Yep.
So what'd you think?
It was pretty cool.
Are you feeling nervous? Or
yes.
Yes? Okay. Are you worried about the recoil?
Yes, a little bit.
Okay, let's just stay away from the pump for a second.
Okay.
I got a gun for you. That's going to fix that.
Now, not wanting to be left out, Josh's mother, Paula, was determined to become comfortable with firing a shotgun. At the end of the day, I think it was pretty neat to see families out participating, and that can only mean a bright future for pheasant hunting in Alberta.
So the transition from hunter to mother, eh?
Yes.
I had an opportunity to chat with Todd Zimmerling, president and CEO of the Alberta Conservation Association, about the Pheasant Festival. Todd, the Pheasant Festival, where did the idea come from to hold a festival like this and in Tabor?
Basically, it was an idea put together by a bunch of different people. Members of the Alberta Conservation Association basically sat down with people from AHIA, Tabor Fish and Game, Lethbridge Fish and Game, Calgary Pheasants Forever, a number of just concerned hunters in Tabor and Lethbridge, and some businessmen, and we all got together as a fairly large group, about 15 people on the organizing committee. I just thought about the idea of trying to promote pheasant hunting. We knew that pheasant hunting numbers have dropped. So we've gone from about 27,000 back in the 80s down to 6,000 this past year. So we were really concerned about that. If the number of hunters continues to drop, well, then we're going to lose pheasant hunting completely. So what could we do to try and help that out and improve the numbers?
What came first, the hunter decline or the number of bird decline? When you look at that from that perspective, Todd, how important is it to get birds back onto the landscape?
I want to be clear, what's important is get the habitat back on the landscape. And so we're not fooling ourselves and thinking we'll just keep throwing birds out there and somehow they'll come back. What we need to do is work on improving habitat. It's going to take several years to improve the habitat. We've had a decline in the habitat over probably a decade, little things that have happened over the years. So to get it back is probably going to take us a decade. But so in that interim, what we want to do is do things like this release to try and promote hunting, keep the interest there, and hopefully, you know, as we move forward, you know, in the next 10 years or so, we start seeing more and more habitat, more and more wild birds, and there's less need to do releases.
I understand that there's already interest in other counties that they would like to step up and get involved perhaps next year or down the road.
We've had a significant amount of interest already from different counties, different towns who would like to do something like this. At this point, we don't have any plans to go anywhere else. We've committed to staying in Tabor and doing the festival here for 3 years. We're hopeful that it will grow and we'll be able to make it a cost-neutral event so that a local group can take it over and do most of the planning, so that allows the organizing group to move on to someplace else and then get another festival started. It might be another pheasant festival, might be a snow goose festival. You know, we're looking at our different options, but basically we do want to move around the province, getting more festivals throughout the province, bringing the economic benefit that comes from having these kinds of events occur. I mean, we're in a town of Tabor, I believe it's close to 8,000 people, and we've brought in 460 hunters to here. It's going to have an economic impact for sure.
Coming up, we go to Grand Prairie for a discussion on the future of Arctic grayling in Alberta.
Alberta Conservation Association. Since 1997, more than $120 million has gone towards conserving wildlife and fish and securing habitat, creating a lasting legacy for Albertans.
Arctic grayling are facing a tough time here in our province, so much so that a conference was held in Grand Prairie. Dr. Mike Sullivan explains Albertans have a very unique connection to this fish.
Grayling are a really neat fish. If you grew up in Alberta fishing, your dad took you out to some river in the Swan Hills or in the Edson area and you went grayling fishing, and you can't do that anymore. Those grayling are almost gone, and a lot of people are kind of shocked at the speed that we lost grayling. So about 10 years ago, grayling biologists all across North America started to pool resources and just saying, okay, we've got some places where we've lost grayling, Montana, down in Michigan, some places where they're really healthy, up in Alaska, some places where we can see they're threatened, British Columbia, Alberta. Let's not reinvent the wheel. Let's learn from each other. So this is the third meeting. First one was in British Columbia, looking at some of the big hydroelectric developments in northern BC. Second one was down in Montana, where they're trying to reintroduce grayling that had been lost through basically a century of intensive development in agriculture. And this one is trying to bring more of that together in Alberta, which still has some good grayling populations, maybe way up in the Caribou Mountains or in some of the foothill streams like the Little Smoky. But we've lost some too. Totally lost, like just outside of Grand Prairie in the Beaver Lodge. So we're really learning from experts. We don't have to reinvent techniques, reinvent 20, 30, 50 years of learning. We can just ask the people that lived through that and give us some better direction. It's good bang for your buck.
When it comes to understanding the drivers which are causing the grayling to disappear, it's boiled down to just a couple of factors.
Habitat, water quality, water quantity, and overfishing. Those are the two big drivers. Folks in the territories, Northwest Territories, the Yukon, Alaska, can really show us, hey, this is the first start of that kind of thing. Folks down in Michigan and Montana goes, and this is the end picture. Alberta, we have the nice range. So it really gives us a good perspective.
And according to biologists like Dr. Sullivan, there is one common denominator that leads to our impact of the grayling's habitat.
But the big picture problem is roads. Roads bring in people, people bring in development. You can just measure road density and you can tell the issues you're going to have with wildlife. Access, over and over, that seems to filter to the top. So we're trying not to pick away at cumulative effects one by one. There's not enough of us and there's too many problems. If you had to pick one, it's the big umbrella, which is ease of access.
The Alberta Hunter Education Instructors Association delivers conservation programs about Alberta's wildlife and fish, which need to be managed for future generations. To date, AHIA has instructed over 1 million students.
Apart from being home to pheasants, southern Alberta is also the native rangeland to antelope. The Alberta Fish and Game Association and Alberta Conservation Association have been working together to remove a potentially deadly barrier. Since its invention back in 1865, barbed wire has been an invaluable tool. But over the years, we have come to learn that in certain instances, it can also hamper the movement of natural wildlife. Case in point, here in southern Alberta, the migration patterns of antelope have been altered because of barbed wire.
What we're going to try and do is we're going to try and get the 3 miles done today.
Well, what it's called, Michael, in a mouthful is the Pronghorn Travel Corridor Enhancement. The ACA in the last few years has gone around and looked at a lot of the fences in the area in prime pronghorn migration routes. And there's some real barriers to the travel here. What most people don't realize is that pronghorns rarely ever jump a fence. They can do it, but it's kind of a last resort. They like to crawl under, but they need about 18 inches to crawl under. So if that bottom wire is set too low, it becomes a real barrier.
We met with some landowners and contacted them and find out who's interested in participating in the project. I mean, it's a great cause, so there's a lot of interest for it, and it's a good way to get some volunteers out and involved.
You know, this whole project wouldn't be successful without the help of countless volunteers. And you get volunteers from the hunting community and non-hunting community. In a way, you could say fences are being mended in more ways than one.
The plight of the pronghorn caught our attention, and so we started to partner with Alberta Fish and Game and the Alberta Conservation Association, and the rest is history. So now we spend 3 weekends a year out here putting smooth wire down to help the pronghorns migrate from Montana up into Alberta and Saskatchewan. And because they're not an endangered species, but nonetheless they need protecting, and the barbed wire is one of the biggest impediments to their migration routes, which they've been using for thousands and thousands of years.
I just think it's such a cool idea. It just seems like a really neat way to be able to spend a couple of days and give something back to the resource. Plus, it's really enjoyable being out here, spending a day, no cell phone to bug you, and in some beautiful country, and meet some neat new people that have the same interests. So it's a very cool idea.
Hey, Michael, you've really got me digging around on this next story. I'll fill you in on what I've discovered a little later on.
Pheasants Forever celebrates its 20th year in Alberta in 2012. We are dedicated to the conservation of pheasants and other upland wildlife through habitat improvements, public awareness, education, and land management policies and programs.
Hi, I'm Brad Fenson with the Alberta Fish and Game Association with your outdoor tip of the week. And this week we're going to be talking about spotting scopes. I often get asked, do I really need a spotting scope if I have good binoculars? Well, the answer is yes, clear and simple. I mean, spotting scopes take things to the next level in terms of getting detail and clarity in terms of what you're looking at. Whether you're a birder looking to identify a specific warbler, or if you're a hunter looking to look at the country beyond what your binoculars and naked eye can see, a spotting scope can do lots for you. And there's lots of different uses for them, and there's lots of different models out there. Some of the plastic-bodied ones that have armor coating, and then of course there's the old metal-bodied ones that are a lot heavier. Big considerations when you're packing. But some of the things that you want to look at When you're shopping for a scope, are the objective lens, which is the diameter or size of the objective, which is going to collect the light and the information that's going to be transmitted to you. The unique thing about using spotting scopes, if you want to share what you see in the field, you can use different digiscoping adapters. This is to put a digital camera on. It fits right on the scope. Your camera mounts on here. It's fully adjustable to get things perfectly leveled. And you take a picture of whatever you're seeing in the field through your spotting scope. Many of the scopes have interchangeable eye pieces, and you can actually just screw them out of the scope itself. And this particular one has a zoom range from 15 power all the way up to 45. Most manufacturers offer some type of package deal where you can get a scope, window mount and tripod, and a carrying case just to keep everything in one spot and well protected. There are a couple other considerations when you're using a spotting scope. You cannot use them handheld, and you can't just set it up on the hood of your vehicle to look at it. You will need a proper tripod or a window mount to hold it steady, and you'll notice that even if the wind is blowing strong, it's still, you're going to get some wiggle and some shake in there in terms of what you see. And you can reduce that by reducing the power in your scope, and it'll help to reduce the magnification and the magnification of the wind or the other effects that you're dealing with. So best of luck in the field, whatever your endeavors are, and whatever you need more magnification for.
When it comes to developing new well sites, the less you disturb Alberta's boreal forest, the better.
Our management group have a commitment to do it right. And one of the other things we did last winter that has never been tried before for core hole is slant wells.
Slant drilling means that up to 6 holes could be drilled from one site. So instead of having to clear 6 different well sites like this, only one is required.
We actually saved 17 hectares of clearing by using slant drilling. It was more expensive than vertical drilling. You know, it worked. We're going to do more again this year.
That Northern Alberta muskeg, it's here.
It's floating.
We're literally walking on water here.
To encourage faster regrowth, Devon Energy transplants small islands of trees and plants.
Shrubs, grasses, you know, Labrador teas, small plants and mosses will start to spread out from here over time. So I'm hoping to come back here next year this time and have this site meet reclamation criteria.
Here in Alberta, we're fortunate enough to have many landscapes, perhaps none as mesmerizing, though, as the one here at Dinosaur Provincial Park in southern Alberta. So not only are we going outdoors, but we're going back in time. Let's go.
Welcome to Dinosaur Provincial Park. My name is Marie. I'm going to be your guide today for the guided excavation program.
Our excavation tour begins here at the Visitor Center. Here you'll find hands-on displays for kids of all ages. It's a great place to learn about the dinosaurs that roamed through the Badlands.
Most of the bones that we're finding are from the same kind of dinosaur. It's a ceratopsian dinosaur called Centrosaurus apertus. It's one of the most common ceratopsians around here.
This isn't exactly the Centrosaurus apertus, but it's a similar looking relative. And luckily, both were plant eaters.
They have a very long nasal horn, hence the name Centrosaurus in the center of the face.
Well, now we know who we're looking for, so off we go to hunt for dinosaur bones. 75 million years ago, the climate here was subtropical with lush forests and rivers that flowed east into a large inland sea.
The kind of work that we're going to be doing today has some dangers to it. There's going to be potentially some rattlesnakes that we might encounter. If we do, they give us a good warning and we just step away. It's not a big deal.
Luckily, Marie went on to say that they haven't seen many rattlers this year. Oh, and one other thing, there's lots of cactus here, so a girl's gotta be careful when she's using the outdoor facilities, if you know what I mean.
So we have a large limb bone, probably a leg bone, either from a hadrosaur or from a ceratopsian.
When dinosaur bones are exposed to the elements, they decompose rather quickly.
You can see here kind of in cross-section, it's just a part of it, like the whole bone would be about this big around. You got your surface, and it's denser, closer to the surface, and then it's porous in the middle, where the marrow was.
Dinosaur bones here are chocolate brown when they are in the ground.
But when they're exposed to the sun, then they bleach and then they turn kind of cream color like this. Also, they're very heavy. So if you take this in your hands, it's just as heavy as a rock would be.
So how did all the dinosaur bones found here all end up in the same place? 75 million years ago, this area was very flat. Large storms from the inland sea flooded the area with water.
The dinosaurs are trapped in water. They have to swim, but they can only swim for so long. So they end up drowning. And as the water recedes, you have these pools of water and pools of carcasses. Sounds very romantic, doesn't it?
That's how a bone bed is formed, and that's what we will be digging in today. This is an active quarry. Paleontologists are currently conducting research here, so we have to be careful to watch our step.
Most of us, what we're going to use is an awl and a polyester brush. Because we're working really slowly, we don't want to be all chisel happy, like I mentioned earlier, with the hammer and chisel and go too fast. Because if we go too fast, we miss things, we break things, we move things out of place.
One by one, Marie shows us our personal digging area.
I would like you to work on this vertebra. So what I would like you to do is slowly take this here down. Can you see the outline of the bone right here?
In a large bone bed like this, bones get scrambled up. Chances of finding the full skeletal remains of a dinosaur in one place are rare. Bones from one dinosaur could be scattered over meters, even kilometers.
It's so nerve-wracking to do this because I feel like anything I sweep or pick up could be a potential dinosaur bone or a fossil.
Not long into my excavation, I make an exciting discovery.
That's not mud. All right, so this here is another bone, right here.
Just an inch away from the already exposed vertebrae on the left sits another bone.
This, you can tell that it's bone because it's nice and elongated and you can feel the nice texture. When you expose a fossil, you're the first human being to ever see it. And I mean, it's been in the ground for 75 million years. This is a horn, either an orbital horn or nasal horn. This is really awesome. This is the first adult horn that's actually coming out of this section of the quarry. Everybody gets really excited and everybody's eyes get, you know, big and round when they see the concentration of fossil that we're dealing with here. Pretty much everyone as a child, if they'd heard of dinosaurs, I want to do that one day. You know, not necessarily be a paleontologist, but I want to dig up dinosaur bones. And they go on the website or they hear about it and they're like, hey, I can do this. I can actually do it. I don't have to be a paleontologist and go to university for years and years in order to be able to dig up dinosaur bones.
All this digging is tough on a city girl's hands. I wonder if there's a manicurist down in the campground.
Sandpaper hands, I call them. I like to use a lot of cream, but yeah, for the summer, I just can't have pretty hands.
Once the dinosaur bone is completely cleared off, Marie adds a consolidant to preserve it.
See the difference it makes in the color? It really highlights it, and then it's a lot easier to see. And this, at the same time, it'll protect it a little bit more from the elements. So it's making the whole bone stronger.
Before we break for lunch, Marie shows us how they remove a bone. A cheesecloth-like material called gypsona is put over the bone, moistened with water, and allowed to dry for a few hours.
There's lots of stuff everywhere. This is a scapula, shoulder blade. What does that look like? Wood, you bet. So that's petrified wood. Looks like somebody was just chopping wood here, but this is actually petrified wood. So yeah, good luck starting a fire with that. This is a crocodile tooth, tip missing again.
In the afternoon, Marie takes us prospecting for microvertebrates, very, very tiny bones. Being in our own backyard, it's easy to take for granted how special the site is. Tourists from all over the world love coming here.
I get teenagers. I take people from 14 years old and up. I had an 80-year-old participant last year that did fantastic and actually found quite a few fossils. All kinds of people, but everyone normally is blown away by the experience.
It amazes me how Marie can immediately identify small fragments.
This is turtle shell carapace fragment. Ironstone. This is a gar scale.
Time to go back to the quarry and check that cast we left earlier.
Just want to make sure that the whole thing comes loose.
The fossil is delicately taken out of the ground and dirt underneath is removed. Wow, the day flew by. It's time to pack up.
Really cool find.
Yeah,
just standing over it looking all proud.
What a great day. If you want to find out more about the guided excavation program at Dinosaur Provincial Park, go to albertaparks.ca. Now, I'm off to find that manicurist.
Wild Sheep Foundation Alberta promotes and enhances wild sheep populations and habitat through the funding of programs that support responsible wildlife management, conservation education, youth involvement, and the preservation of our hunting heritage.
By all accounts, the week has been a success. Still, there is some concern over the future of pheasant hunting in our province. There has been a significant decline in both the number of hunters and the number of pheasants being released. Some months ago, a new organization was formed called Upland Game Birds Alberta. Ken Bailey is the spokesman. Why, in the first place, I guess, is there another group that is concerned about pheasants and keeping pheasants on the landscape and also bringing more hunters into the equation?
What caught the attention of the fellows who are behind Upland Birds Alberta is the significant decline we've seen in pheasant hunter numbers in the province in a very short period of time, really disproportional to declines in other types of hunting. And when they looked at it, they saw very clearly it was associated with the decline in the put-and-take or raise-and-release program, as some prefer to call it, in Alberta. As recently as 20 years ago, late 80s, early 90s, we had 20,000 pheasant hunters in Alberta and were releasing about 70,000 birds per year. That release program is down to under 14,000 birds each year now, and the pheasant hunter numbers, as you're aware, is under 6,000.
You folks have actually put together a survey.
I think the realistic question that needed to be asked is, if we're going to invest in a put-and-take program in our province, that there needs to be a positive return on that investment. And there was no data out there. So we undertook this survey to determine that very, very, very question. What is the economic return to Albertans for investing in pheasants and pheasant hunting? We actually, through the support of SRD, sent a letter out to all those who held a pheasant license last year and encouraging them to participate in the online survey. There's less than 6,000 pheasant hunters. We had somewhere in the order of 1,300 people respond, visit the survey site. So we're absolutely thrilled the number of people who participated. It really underscores, I think, how passionate people are about pheasants in Alberta, and the fact that that number of people took the time to take the survey will really bring credibility to our results.
Do you feel that down the road it might just be events like this that we have that opportunity to hunt pheasants, or are you hoping that, again, that the pheasants will be back on the landscape?
We'd like to see the raise and release program grow back to the levels that it was in the late 80s, you know, of somewhere around 60, 70, 80,000 birds per year being released to supplement the wild populations. If we can get there, we're once again going to see the glory years in Alberta, where Brooks and southern Alberta was the place in North America to be for pheasants and pheasant hunting. And if you wanted a local hotel room in October, you best book it in March. We think that we can get back to those days. And I think when you see the positive results we've seen with this Pheasant Festival and the way people are talking about it, the excitement of the local community, I think it's all going to be part and parcel of a reinvigorated pheasant hunting culture in Alberta.
Canada's cold water resources need you. Trout Unlimited Canada delivers conservation results for our freshwater ecosystems and their cold water resources. Our work includes stream restoration, scientific research, and education through our Yellowfish Road program.
Now, if you would like to catch previous stories featured on Let's Go Outdoors, then track down our website at letsgooutdoors.ca. Remember, the outdoors is here for all of us to enjoy. If you see someone taking away from that enjoyment, call the Report a Poacher line. Till next time, I'm Michael Short. Let's go outdoors.
I know where I want to be. Outside, wild and free. Let's go outdoors. Let's go outdoors. You and me. Let's go outdoors where the waters run clear and cold. Mother Nature's world is better than gold. So much to see, so much to do.